Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. So first of all, thank you for making it on time for our third day's program, especially after I heard you had a pretty good party last night. Most of you left at maybe after 10 p.m., something like that. So I do appreciate that you can come and join our presentation today. So we will start today's program with the keynote presentation given by Dr. Liu Yu from Inspur, China. You probably heard about Inspur, the name of Inspur. In Chinese, actually, the name means the wave or the tide, you know, the topic that Professor Chow was talking about yesterday. So it's really making some wave. I think the most recent number, your company has maybe over 80 systems in the top 500 list. So it's quite some accomplishment they have made in the recent years. So Dr. Liu, I have known him for quite a while. He's coming from a background of computational physics. But his role is a little bit similar to me at the Supercomputing Center. So he's in charge of the HPC application support team in Inspur, which means he gets the honor or say the role to deal with scientists from all these different domains. He needs to optimize and tune all different kinds of code. The last time when I met with him, we were in Saudi Arabia trying to optimize their climate modeling code. So you can see, he will tell you some more stories in his slides. So now I should give the time to Dr. Liu to share with you his fantastic experience at the Inspur. Let's welcome him.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Professor Fu. Good morning, everyone. I come from Inspur and I'm Liu Yu. It is very good, great honor for me to show our work to the world. I think before Professor Fu has introduced our company, I think most of you do not have heard Inspur before. So who are we? Just as Professor Fu just said, we are an international server manufacturer all over the world, and we have shared the number three server market around the world, and number one in China. And also, we are the famous HPC and AI server provider and solution provider in China and all over the world. And also, we have a great participant in the open computing organizations such as the OCP, ODCC, and Open19. Besides, I want to say that we are the only one company who can both provide the power chips and the x86 chips around the world. And Inspur has a lot of research and design centers around the world and factories around the world. In the Europe, our base is located at the Frankfurt in Germany, and our factory in Europe is in Hungary. Okay, and so we can provide the European customer with the local service. Because of many years of experience in the high-performance computing, Inspur also have found that there are a lot of challenges in the supercomputing. You know that we make supercomputers to help our scientific research. However, you know that today's supercomputers are very big and large and large. However, most of our scientists think that our calculation work have not been accelerated as the computer grows. The big problem is that the complex architecture, you can see that the number one computers, the architecture has improved from the single CPU processor to a lot of accelerators and even complex architectures. So there are a big problem is that the hardware utilization will be very low because the new hardware, our software is old, we cannot use that. So the application scalability would also be very bad. So how can we solve this problem? First of all, our supercomputers is built just for computing. So the main component of our supercomputers is the compute component. Yeah, like the CPUs, GPUs, and other accelerators. So if we want our compute component to run as much fast with no bottlenecks, so the data input or output must be no bottlenecks, like the storage I/O bandwidth, the memory bandwidth, PCIe, or NVLink, and other bandwidth, and so on. Because our today's work are very large, we are among a lot of computing nodes, so the communication between the nodes should not be a bottleneck. So how can we solve this problem? For many years of experience of HPC innovation, Inspur summarized our three strategies. That is, we first build a powerful profiling tool, and then use the newest or the state-of-the-art hardwares, and then we have to move our latest algorithm on physical models to that hardwares. So somebody may ask, what is building a powerful profiling tool? And what is a profiling tool? Why have we to build that? I want to say that there is a very old Chinese saying. I don't know whether you have seen that before. It's in Chinese, we call it the 工欲善其事,必先利其器. In the English, it means that if you want to sharp, make a good work, you have to sharp your tools. You can see this, You can see this interesting picture, yeah. If you want your work much good or the efficiency, so you must sharp your tools. So from the previous slides, we see that we want to help our computing run faster. We have to make our compute components, data throughput component, and the communication components no bottleneck and run as fast as possible. So first of all, we have to see whether it's fast enough or whether there are bottlenecks. So for the computing component, we are not only have to see the utilization rate, like the user says, and I wait and so on. But we also have to see the actual floating point speed while our application is running. Yeah. So, and which component or which instruction size has been provided that floating point? Besides, for the memory bandwidth or the PCIe bandwidth or the I/O bandwidth are also the great index to see whether there are bottlenecks for our data input into the compute component. Okay, and also the infinite band or the OPA bandwidth. Here we list the three figures here. You can see that here is the floating point speed where our application is running, and here is memory bandwidth. We can see that some applications, you are nearly 200 gigabytes in a single node, so maybe that is some kind of bottleneck. So somebody may ask, we can use some open source or Intel's WeTune to do that. But I want to emphasize is that because our supercomputer is a big or a huge machine, so it's not a desktop series, a desktop machine. So your work had to just as the forest, you just not have to see the single trees, but you have to see the whole behavior of what the forest have to do. So the profiling tool is very important. In the following, I will show several cases to see why the profiling tool is very important. Here, I list the first example to show the powerful tool's real power, okay? Here I list the state-of-art atmospheric modeling system, that is WOLF. We know that this is a very complex model, and some of the algorithm may be old. So, and it's also a compute-intensive application. So if we want to make this application run much faster, we must do some computing or communication optimization. Our work for this optimization is doing for one of our customers in China. They want to do a simulation of the North China's weather forecast, which covers about 60 hours weather forecasting. And they want to do that is the total computing process would be less than 2 hours, which includes the WPS process, Wolf computing process, and also the post-processing process. However, and first, our customer claims that the fastest time, the fastest time of only the Wolf computing would last more than 150 minutes. So how can we solve this problem? First of all, we have to use a tool to see what's happened while the Wolf is running. Here we list the floating point speed while the Wolf is running. And we can see that there are a lot of gaps between the floating point, which means that there is no actual computing. Since we analyzed into details, we found that these are a lot of I/O process. So first of all, maybe we have to optimize our I/O bandwidth. Besides, we have seen that and more is that the floating point is very low, yeah, and the interaction size may be not efficiency, but this is later work. So first of all, we have to optimize our I/O bandwidth. And we did three things, three parts. The first one is the last performance, and we use quit I/O in our name list, and also the PNet CF. You can see that after optimization, and the gaps are nearly disappeared. But there is a big problem in that. You can see that the maximum of the network flux has been increased. Yeah, and then there is a continuous feature of the network flux. This may affect our application's scalability. So the next one, what we have to do is to slow down, little down the maximum of the network flux. What we do is to change the, to make the MPI process fewer. Because we know that if there are a lot of MPI process with the communication, the communication is very complex. So if we can use some OpenMP mode, the communication complexity may be lower down. That is what we have done. And we can see that after this optimization, the network flux has been done very efficiently, and the performance has been improved. And also, after the MPI optimization, the memory bandwidth has also been dropped, which is very useful for our performance improving. And we can see that we just did a very simple optimization. It's very simple, just by see what's happened for the application running. You can see that we have a very great performance improvement. So since we show that the real power of the profiling tool. But I have already showed that, you know that from the application features by the profiling tool, we also have the running feature is that the floating point is not very high, and some kind of the interaction site has not been efficiently used. So the next thing of our optimization strategy is that you have to make the new hardwares or new the architectures must be efficiency. So that is the hardness of the state of the architecture. Okay. Here I show why this is very important. Because if we our application can use the new architecture and the new instruction size, it means that the machine's performance will be released fully. Here we show three cases that what we have done in the Tianhe 2 supercomputer in China. You know that the Tianhe 2 is a structure, it's an architecture with Intel Xeon CPUs and also the MIC processors. So we optimize these applications on the system machine, and with the lamps, we can scalable to more than 24,000 cars, and the quantized spatial with more than 20,000 cars. And also, this GTC is a plasma simulation application, which we both use the MIC and the Xeon processors, and we can use more than 400,000 cars on this machine. So it is very useful for the state-of-the-art architectures optimization. For details, I'll show you a case to show how can we do this work. This is another global scale atmospheric modeling system, which is developed by one of our customers. And they simulates the global weather forecast with a resolution of 0.125 degrees. And they want to make the simulation less than 3 hours. However, and first, they use more than 8,000 cars, but the simulation time is very long, more than 1 day. So we have to analyze what's wrong with the application. First of all, we list the most time-causing, consuming functions, and also the program parts of what happened while the program is running. We can see that the most of the time-consuming part is model integration, which we look refer to the Helmholtz equation. It's nearly 50%. And here we list the features while the application is running. We also can see that the total floating point is not very high for today's hardware architectures. And we can see that most of the instruction sets are provided by SSC. However, the most powerful instruction set, AVS, has not been used. So this is the very important thing for us to optimize. We know that the original code, say, so the Helmholtz equations is to decrease into this form. And this form is as AX equals B. We know that this is to solve a sparse matrix. We know that this form is a common one. There are a lot of commercial or open source mathematical libraries has been optimized for this kind of computing. So if we can use a highly optimized code for this computing, maybe we can accelerate the Helmholtz equations computing. That is what we have done. Besides, for more things, if we can lower the number of iterations, because we know that some of the usually we solve the Helmholtz equation by iteration method. So if we can lower the number of iterations, the total running time would be shorted. Okay. And the original one, we can see that they are using the GCR method. So we we under just a preconditioner. However, the total improvement is very bad. For another thing, we do another do some more works to change the preconditioner GCR method to a GMRM method with the MKL library and the hyper preconditioners. And this is a very great improvement for the computing. And we can see that after this optimization, the total floating point has been improved nearly twice, okay, and the instruction size has been improved from the SSE to the AVX, so we can see that we have efficiently used the newly architectures. And here is the total time, and you can see that the model integration time has been increased 61%, and the total running time has also increased 40. We can see that the number of iterations has been reduced from 32 to 8 iterations. So it is a good improvement for our work. And for another case is that we have to do some more work for our supercomputers applications. Here we can see that most of the supercomputer centers around the world will run a lot of applications. And some of the applications like WASP is very important. WASP is applications for the material science and the quantum physics application. And sometimes it will take more than 20% of CPU hours around the supercomputer centers. And because WASP was a feature, it's just like LeanPack. So you know that the power consuming for this kind of applications is very high, maybe take 30 or 50% of the total power consuming consumption. So it is very important for us to optimize the WASP application. And we take a very famous or hot research field for the material science. We use a Hustler alloy, which contains about nearly 300 atoms, and we use the plane wave base site, and you know that the computing amount of this case would be some kind of large. Well, we do the same thing. We see what happened while the application is running. And you can see that nearly half of the time consuming is caused by the DGEMM functions, which is to solve the eigenvalue problem. And also, we can see that nearly the other half is caused by the MPI withdraw and MPI all reduce functions, which means that the communication is banned. This will affect our applications, cannot make a big scalability. So we have to see what's happened. And we see that the floating point is not very high, and the interacting sites only use SSD instead of the previous optimization we showed you. And we did the three things is that first, we have to optimize these eigenvalue functions, and then we have to do some memory access optimization, because we know that once we use the plane wave base site, which in the memory, it would be a lot of arrays. So the memory access would be very intensive. So we have to optimize the memory access, like the both settings and also the codings. Besides, which is very important, is that the network, because we can see that nearly half of the time is caused by the MPI functions. So we have to make some of the modeling to make sure the running of the WASP is suitable for our supercomputer's topology. Okay, so we change some of the parameters in the in-cars, and also we optimize the collective communication functions. And after optimization, you can see that the floating point has been increased very great. And most of the applications are running with the AVX 512 interacting site. And you can see that the total performance has been increased nearly 228%. Besides, I want to say that to show the different interacting sites' performance, you know that with Xeon's E5-2650 processors, it only have AVX interacting site. And the V3 processors, we have the AVX and the FME interaction site. And from here to here, we can see that the performance has been increased 90%, which means that the FME interaction site is very efficient. And also, from the V3 processor to the newly Xeon scalable family processors, we can see that the most difference is the AVX interaction site and the AVX 512 interaction site. We can see that the with the vectorization from 256 to 512, the performance has been increased nearly 17%. So that is to show why the state-of-the-art hardware is very important for us to optimize our applications. And here we show the after optimization, the network flux. And we can see that this is a non-persistent network, which is conducive to improving application scalability, because sometimes we can harden the communications into our computing part. However, the scalability of WASP, because it's a commercial code, you know that it's not very good. So if we want to make this kind of application to run into millions of cars, this kind of commercial code may not work. We have to do a lot of work for the commercial codes, the physical models to suitable to our supercomputers architectures. So here come to the third part, is that we must leverage the latest model algorithm, which means that we must optimize or develop the new algorithm or new physical models which is suitable for today's supercomputers architectures and topologicals. Here I list a timeline, which is also in the quantum physics areas. And we can see that a lot of the algorithm or the theories are some kind of old. When I say old, because these algorithms are developed decades before. So today, a lot of the applications, like the WASP applications that I just show you, is also based on this kind of theories. So because just this kind of theories, the parallel modes degree has been limited into this part. So the total scalability may be very low. That is why WASP is scalability is not good. So we must do the mode optimization is by two parts, the applications sense and also the computing sense. So it's some kind of interdisciplinary work. Because for our application sense, we must think or must develop our algorithm, our mode to suitable for our computers. And also for our computer scientists, we must think our new architecture to suitable for applications. So if we can make these two parts work together, so large scale complication would be reached. And the fourth case we show here is to show how can we do that. It's also work we did for our customers in China. This is kind of code for simulating new spintronics, spintronics, because we know that today's processors, like the desktops, our supercomputers, are based on the a lot of semiconductors. Okay, the silicon. You know that we use the spin. We use the voltage high and low to represent bit one or zero. However, if we can use the electron spin, which is at the spin right up and the spin down to represent the bit one or zero, the total power consumption will be reduced nearly 100,000 times. So if we can use spintronics to make our processors, maybe our supercomputers, power problem may be maybe not a problem, okay? And also, maybe our cell phones do not need to recharge every day. However, their code is very bad. So the work is very great. The code is very bad. They only can simulate near just use 10 cars, okay? Very, very low, just in a desktop. And the matrix scale is less than the power of 10 of the 4, and they can only simulate 3 electrons. So we analyze the problem. They use the configuration in the action method, which just like our atoms, we know that a lot, for most of the time, the electrons are located in a very low energy state. However, they make the simulation with a full consideration of the non-occupied state. We know that there are a lot of waste for the computation. So for our optimization mode, the first thing is that we can get rid of this useless computing. And besides, they use the full matrix to restore the record the sparse matrix, which means that there are a lot of memory waste in the record the zero ones. So we did the optimization just to change the full CI to the partial CI. And also, we changed the QR method to an iteration method, which is suitable for parallelism. And also, we optimized the vector interactions and also the collective communications. And after that, you can see that there is a very great performance improvement. And the total parallel degree is from 10 cars to nearly 4,000 of cars. And the most important is that they can do a lot of new works. With this code, they have submitted a lot of works in the physics review letters and some of the famous scientific research articles. Okay. And last, I will show another case to why the modeling innovation is very important. Here, I know a lot of your professors here are doing the global climate simulation work because you know that the climate simulation is complex because it will couple a lot of the computing components or physical components to simulate, to make the simulation. And with resolution increased, the total number of the total number of calculation will increase very much. So it is difficult for us to make the, a very exact or climate change just using little or small supercomputers. So we must make our code run as large as possible. However, our customers in China make this code is very poor because they can only simulate the code in nearly less than 1,000 of cars, several hundred, and they for they want to simulate a decade simulation will take over 2 days. So this is a big problem. We did the optimization together with them, and we found that the file part of the application listed here, and you can see that most time-consuming part, except the ATM component, the other four, is MPI. So we can see that there is a big problem. The ATM is a bottleneck. And we did some details analyze of this code. And we found that this kind of code is some kind of ATM driver, which means that the other component, like the land and ATM and ice and ocean, are coupled with this ATM driver. So the ATM would be a bottleneck. So the most of the thing is that we have to change this pseudo parallel mode into a real parallel mode. We change the ATM driver to a CPL driver, which means that the ATM's bottlenecks have been bricked. And also, we optimize ATM with the MPI plus OpenMP mode. And you can see that after this kind of optimization, the total performance has been increased nearly twice. And also, the ATM has also increased 20%. So today, I showed our methods to realize large-scale computing. We use three strategies to take the runtime performance data with a powerful profiling tool. And with the profiling data, we know the application's features, and we know whether there is a bottleneck. So we can do the state-of-art technologies innovation, and also we can do the interdisciplinary innovation for the new models to optimize our application work, so we can achieve a great application's performance. However, maybe you can consider that the most important thing and the difficult thing is interdisciplinary innovation, because we lack of these talent to do that. Some of our computer scientists only famous our computing work. However, our scientists from other research fields like physics and chemistry and so on, they only know their own research work. They do not understand the computer science. So there is a big gap. So the most of the important thing may be to train the people who know both parts. So one more thing I want to introduce the ASC student computer challenge. This computer challenge provide a stage for the student practicing large-scale HPC optimization. This kind of event has been held 8 years. It started in the 2012. And over 7,000 young talent has joined this event, and more than 300 universities around the world have come into this wonderful event. And a lot of the young talents in this event has made a very good job. You can see that and the AS14. Some of the young talent has optimized a three-dimensional elliptic wave model on the Tianhe 2 supercomputers with more than 200,000 cars. And the AS17, in the some of the young talent use the Sunway type light to simulate a Golden Bell Prize nominated application Magnum with more than 10,000 cars. So you can see that the young talents are very powerful for tomorrow's or future's supercomputers work. So maybe I can release a video to you to see what happens or what is the ASC event. And we also like all of your professors to encourage your students to come into this event and have a great experience with large scale HPC application. So this is a video we take from this year's ASC19 ASC event.
We are all focused. We work together. We have the same goal. To explore more unknowns. To find more possibilities. To achieve a better future.
Remarkable.
5 days, 20 teams, new competitions. Set sail again.
I think this team competition is 以前的比赛中呢，只有对抗，现在有了合作与对抗，就觉得是一个很新奇的东西，而且我觉得大家都会去投入这个事情中去，是一个很好的新的比赛项目。
这次超级团队赛的设置，加强了我们与其他队伍之间的合作和交流。不像我们之前每个队伍都是各自为战，这次我们会互相分享一些优化的经验，然后互相帮助协同作战，是一种很不错的体验。So everyone
is kind of competitive, but still very friendly and helpful. Like, you can easily talk to other teams, and well, they will actually help you. They're willing to help you. I like it.
You know that this is a very interesting event, and we are focused on to makes our undergraduate student training to for tomorrow's supercomputers scientists. Okay, this is what I show today. Thank you very much for your time. Thank you.
Nice talk. Any questions from the audience?
I have a question because it's really a kind of dream work you are doing for optimization of existing already applications. And it's understood you have these three pillars, so you can improvement already existing codes and you can improve the code. How actually it happens? I mean, users coming to your firm and you have a contract or you're working together, it's a teamwork, it's for how many years typically? How long does it take and how it happens? Is it contract and they pay your team or the team is going to the institution?
I'm sorry, you mean?
No, I mean, for example, okay, this climate people coming to your firm and say, okay, we have this code and we want to improve it, we want to optimize it. And how then it happens? You conclude a contract with this firm and—
Okay. Most of the time, we'll work with our customers together. First of all, you know that the optimization will take a lot of take a very long time to do that work, and it's very difficult. And we have a special application teams, that is my team, and we have experts to work with our customers together to simulate and to analyze what their application is and what their aim is for. And after that, we will make some of the tests with their applications or their workloads, and then find the bottlenecks, and then we did the optimization. Maybe some kind of the computing works is doing by our teams, and some of the physical models you can see that maybe work by our customers. But we have to work together. You know that it's interdisciplinary work, and usually this procedure will last several months or even years. So before we achieve a very great or useful performance, that is the total procedure.
Okay. Question actually was how to become your customer.
I'm sorry. Yeah. So this is my colleague. Yeah. Okay.
Okay. You show very nice for optimization for WRF, but WRF is a as far as I understand an open source project, right? What is your policy of feeding back your optimization to the community, to the project that to the open source projects that you use?
Okay.
Does this optimization actually find their way back into the uh-huh. main development trunk?
Okay. At present, we have not put our optimized code into the communication into the community. You know that there are a lot of the codes are developed by our customers themselves. There is an in-house code, so maybe this kind of code we cannot just upload into the GitHub and so on. And for the other open source optimization, like the LAMPS or quantized space and so on, we showed in the Tianhe 2 Express, Tianhe 2 supercomputers, we haven't uploaded into the community because maybe the computer centers won't like us to do that. I don't know why. Okay.
So I have a question. I mean, your company sells both hardware and I guess software services, or at least you have shown that software is very important to make good use of the hardware. If you would have to advise people how to invest their money, would you say 50% for the hardware, 50% for the software, or what do you think is a good ratio of investment?
Oh, you mean for the solution, HPC solution? Okay.
If you look for the holistic solution, uh-huh. a system that runs the application best, okay. how would you uh-huh. invest?
For my opinion, I think the software is more important than hardware. So I think you have to put more than 50% on the software, not the hardware.
Good, I will take your answer to whoever funds this.
Does your boss agree with you?
Maybe not. So it's my own opinion. Okay. Yeah. Okay.
Okay, if no more questions, let's thank our speaker again.
Thank you very much.